Pentecost Day to all of you. And welcome to our church online here with St. Andrew's Church in Broadfields in Edgware. We're delighted to have all of you, our congregations online and those here at home on Zoom, and later on this evening on YouTube. We hope that as we celebrate the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, we will be able to see the goodness of God, that his love will come upon us, that his power will transform and change us. So grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And together we pray. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. So may God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Holy Spirit sent by the Father, ignite in us your holy fire. Strengthen your children with a gift of faith. Revive your church with a breath of love, and renew the face of the world through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so we come to a time of prayer. Please join in the words in bold. As we wait in silence,
fill us with your Spirit.
As we listen to your word,
fill us with your Spirit.
As we worship you in majesty,
fill us with your Spirit.
As we long for your refreshing,
fill us with your Spirit.
As we long for your renewing,
fill us with your Spirit.
As we long for your equipping,
fill us with your Spirit.
As we long for your empowering,
fill us with your Spirit.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Today we remember the coming of the Holy Spirit, all's power on the disciples. And so we invite that same power to come into our lives, to drive us into his world, to be true witnesses. Be with us, Spirit of God.
Nothing can separate us from your love.
Breathe on us, breath of God.
Fill us with your saving power.
Speak in us, wisdom of God.
Bring strength, healing, and peace.
Let's pray that the Spirit will work throughout our lives to bring Christ into the world.
The Holy Spirit comes to Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, 'What does this mean?' Some, however, made fun of them and said, 'They have had too much wine.'"
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. This is the air I breathe.
Peter addresses the crowd. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd, fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem. Let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit on in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
And so today we are here to celebrate Pentecost Day. Some have rightly called it the beginning of the church. And probably rightly so, because on this day of days, we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit on the disciples to launch the church of God. Last week, we're interesting. We had a very good celebration in this country. I don't know whether it passed you without noticing, but it was the spirit of Dunkirk, of the thousands of boats and ships that went over to Dunkirk to evacuate British soldiers. That was a momentous day for this nation. They call it the biggest evacuation of an army in history. But today we do something more than your hearts and minds can imagine. Because on this day, God launched a movement. On this day, God transformed ordinary men and women into a powerful movement that changed the world at that time. Today, I want us to focus on the Holy Spirit as the empowering presence of God in his church. The word empowerment is very common. It's a word that is used very often. It means delegating power to somebody or authority to people. But it can mean also enabling someone to do something. And this is the understanding of empowerment that I want to share with you on the day of Pentecost. And so 50 days after Passover, after the death of our Lord Jesus Christ, the disciples, of course, have come back from Mount of Olives after the ascension of our Savior. They come in joy, and yet they are perplexed. For some, it's a disappointment because, you know, Jesus at one time, they followed for 3 years, and then he was handed over and he died. But then the miracle of the resurrection brought some hope, only for 40 days later for him to say he was going now physically forever. But they must wait for the gift of the Father. And this is what happens on the day of Pentecost, the fulfillment of this promise of the Father. It is what actually moved the church. But it's interesting, the composition of people who were in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. When you read John chapter 1 from verse 15, we know that it included the 12 disciples who were later to be the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. It also included the women who followed Jesus. And there was also Mary, the mother of Jesus. And then Luke tells us in verse 15 that there were also about 120 people at one time who were present as they prayed and organized the leadership of the church. The story is in two parts, isn't it? The first part from 1 and, to 12 talks about the event of Pentecost. And Luke describes it in such a way, you cannot miss it. He talks about, the coming of the Spirit, first of all, heard like the sound of the wind. And then secondly, seen as thongs of fire separated on top of the disciples. And then thirdly, the result was that they spoke in other languages, proclaiming the goodness of God. And thus the people of God are filled with the Holy Spirit. Clearly something had happened. And this is what Peter explains from verse 14. Because we are told that there were people who reacted very differently. They were bewildered, they were amazed, but some made fun of them. They thought that the people were drunk. And so as Peter continues from verse 14 to explain that what they've seen is no ordinary thing. It's not about people getting drunk so early in the morning, but it is about God fulfilling his own promise, according to the prophet Joel. I will pour out my spirit on all people. And verse 21, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Now, this sudden transformation of the disciples showed that God can change people. God can transform people in various circumstances. And today, what I want us to talk about specifically is this empowerment. Empowerment is that key word that is used often today in motivational speakers, in areas of a lot of need. We hear about those. We hear empowerment also spoken alongside powerlessness. When people are powerless, we often hear they are empowered to do something. And so it's very important that we are clear. When people are empowered, something happens. They are enabled and they are willing to take charge of their own lives. They realize that actually they are responsible for their lives and they can do something about their lives. They no longer have to wait for other people to do it for them. So it is important when people are empowered that they begin to do things. And this is what happened at Pentecost. I mean, recently, I don't know whether you saw, there's a man who used to be on television in the 1990s, Mr. Motivator. Have you seen him doing his exercises? Whatever you are, whether you are lazy, whether you are what, the couch potato person, whether you don't want to do anything, if Mr. Motivator gets you into action, when you see him in action, from the things he will say and do, you slowly get into it and you get entangled in it and you begin to do things you never did before. These days, actually, football teams pay people, motivational speakers, to speak to their teams. We hear of captains speaking to people, giving motivational speeches when they are losing. And that is very, very important. One other example that I want to talk about is, you know, the past experience of loans and grants and aid policy in Africa and in Asia. In those days, when people were in need, when there's a drought, people will send food to them. And then again, the food will finish. Another year, there will be a drought and people will send more food to them. But the governments of the African nations and other nations are saying, that is not the kind of programs we want. The kind of help we need are the ones that will empower our people to do something for themselves. They are looking for educational programs. They are looking for training programs. They are looking for technology and industry, for tools of farming, for boreholes that will last forever. They don't need just food, food, food again. They need things that will empower them, that will enable them to grow food for themselves, to develop industry, to develop their own people so that they can survive in the long term. People of God, the policy of empowerment is great because it changes life. And that is exactly what the Holy Spirit did that day. But let's see the difference between the time before the Holy Spirit came on the apostles and the time afterwards then. The situation was very difficult. They had been first given the great commandment to go and make disciples of all the nations. But where do we find them? They are in the upper room. Some of them are terrified. Some of them are confused. They are in the upper room, actually powerless in the face of the threats of the Jewish leaders. They are also crippled probably by fear, just the fear of inadequacy. But there's something also. It's about transition in life, isn't it? Now that Jesus is not there, how are they going to move on to the next stage of their lives and take control of the ministry God has given them? And again, the change that comes with these things was also fear for them. There's so much uncertainties ahead that they were crippled. They needed to be empowered. And that's exactly what the coming of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost did. The images of wind and of fire are seen to be the power of God. It's the power of God to refine people. It's the power of God to transform people. That is the wind that can move all things, the fire that can make us right people to be used by God. And so we see that after the coming of the Holy Spirit on the disciples, they are given a new energy for life. They are given courage. In the past, they were hiding. These are the same people who denied their master when he was being taken over to be killed. They are the ones who scattered. They're the ones who brought embarrassment to their own group. But now we see Peter and the 12 standing in the center of town and preaching the good news of God. The Holy Spirit had done something wonderful. He's giving them a love and a passion to get on with the task ahead. The Holy Spirit is an empowering presence. Today, as we think of and celebrate Pentecost Day, we are living in similar times, actually. We live under persecution of the fear of COVID-19, of the lockdown, of death that is very threatening. We live in fear of even going outside and getting infection. We live in the times where parents are afraid to take their children back to school. Teachers are afraid that people will infect them. We need God's empowering presence. What about employees going back to work? Is there going to be any jobs for them from October? That is a question they are asking. They fear redundancy. And then the company employers, they fear that their company may break down. They're going to face insolvency or bankruptcy because of the lack of economic activities. But also there's a fear for our young people, isn't it? Will they complete their exams? Are they able to live the life that they need to live? Are they able to continue to develop their own potentials that God has given them? My brother, my sister today, only look up to the God who brought his spirit upon the people to change their lives. We need a motivator, the motivating spirit, that empowering presence of God. You know what? Last few days ago, I saw on television McDonald's driving through, which has just been reopened. There were so many long queues of people looking for food, McDonald's burger. People ordering pizzas. People wanting food to eat, food that comes and lasts no longer than 24 hours in our body. If food that doesn't last more than 24 hours is so much desired that people will queue for hours for it, how much more the Holy Spirit of God? God's Spirit is here today. He's here to equip the young people with gifts, amazing gifts to fulfill their potential. He's here to tell them that there are opportunities that are ahead of them, that there is hope in the world in which we live. God's Spirit is here, available today, to equip you and I to be true servants of God, to be witnesses. Jesus said, when my Spirit come upon you, you will receive power. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. His power is here. Jesus' Spirit is here today to strengthen the weak, to be comfort those who are grieving. Jesus' power is here today to be a companion when we feel lonely or alone. Jesus' power is here today to comfort those who are mourning. Jesus' power is here today to bring love into our communities that we may serve one another. Jesus' power is here today to bring courage to each one of us in the days ahead. For the Spirit is not a spirit of timidity. God's Spirit is a spirit of power that is able to equip us with gifts, amazing and abundant gifts, so that we can do all things for him. Friends, as I bring this to an end, I want to know what your response to the Spirit is. Will you open yourself to God to renew and to refresh you, to empower you for the next steps in your lives? He's available for individuals. He's available for the Church of God. He's available for the community. He's available for young and old. He's available for men and women. He's available to make you an effective person to live your life to the full. Holy Spirit is here. Let's receive him. Let's open ourselves to his work. For he is here.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of love when my heart becomes free. And my shame is enough. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the
Let's open ourselves as we pray now in our homes and wherever we are.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood our homes and change the atmosphere. Father, we come together and pray as one church. Let's set aside the distractions, resist going for the next cup of tea or coffee, and spend this time praying together. Father, we do long for your Spirit to come afresh on your church, on us as individuals and into our homes, that the burning fire of your presence would extinguish any infection and reluctance on our part. I'm going to use a way of praying that a lady I was listening to during last week has written about. She says, keep prayer simple. Three things: say help, thanks, and wow. So I want to start with help, because I always find I need that before I can go on to say the other two things. An American pastor wrote, Thomas Merton wrote, "My God, I have no idea where I'm going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end, nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think I'm following your will does not mean I'm actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I'm doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may not know nothing about it. Therefore, I will trust you always, though I may seem to be lost sometimes. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen." So we pray for help. We pray for your Holy Spirit to just enliven us, to deal with that sense of lethargy that sometimes comes when we're stuck at home and we can't do the things we normally do. We ask, Lord, for patience with each other when we're living together more closely than we ever did and can't spend time away. We pray, Lord, that you just give us that hope. Lord, we just spend a moment praying for our clergy. Let's just pray together in silence for each of our clergy by name. And now, for those especially on our minds, I'm thinking particularly at the moment for Betty as she attends her brother-in-law's funeral this Monday, and for Kostakis planning his mother's funeral. Let's just think of other people that come to our minds now and just pray for them quietly. I'm thinking particularly of Clive at the moment, and we pray that you would bless him and the staff in the home looking after him, and let him know that you are his God. So we can move on to thanks. Some more words from Thomas Merton. To be grateful is to recognize the love of God in everything. Everything he's given us, and he has given us everything. Every breath we draw is a gift of his love. Every moment of existence is a grace, for it brings with it immense grace from him. Gratitude, therefore, takes nothing for granted. It's never unresponsive. It constantly awakes new wonder to praise the goodness of God. For the grateful person knows that God is good. Not by hearsight, hearsay, but by experience. And that's what makes a difference. So a couple of my thank yous, and then we'll have a quiet time when you can just say that your thank yous to God. Thank you, Lord, for giving us so much sunshine while we've been stuck at home. Thank you for the space in our gardens, if we have them, to enjoy your nature. Thank you for the bird song that we can hear more clearly now. Let's spend a moment quietly just saying thank you to God. So let's move on to wow. We perhaps don't do enough wow praying, but your word constantly reminds us of your love for each of us and that you are unchanging. Malachi 3 says, "For I, the Lord, do not change." The New Testament says, "Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever." Lord, we just ask that we'll find new delight in your words in the Bible. They will give us hope and a look forward to the future. An American pastor called Walter Wink says, "Hope imagines the future, then acts as if the future is irresistible." So, Lord, we pray that as the world makes the first faltering steps to return to something like normal, that we will be acting on our hope in you, that you are the irresistible power, and that power that conquered the grave lives in us by your Holy Spirit. And just finishing with some words from Philippians 4. "Rejoice in the Lord always. I say again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen."
Brothers and sisters, in the last 50 days, we've celebrated a victory in our Lord Jesus Christ's power of life over sin and death. In various ways, we proclaim the mighty acts of God, and we have been witnesses of these things. But now, as part of God's church, I want to call you upon you now to come together as one church to declare a commitment to God and to subject ourselves to the Spirit of God. So I'm going to ask you some few words, and the response will come on the screen. Will you dare to embrace each other and grow together in love?
We will.
Will you dare to share your riches in common and minister to each other in need?
We will.
Will you dare to pray for each other until your hearts beat with the longings of God?
We will.
Will you dare to carry the light of Christ into the world's dark places?
We will.
Let's think of these words from the Apostle Paul. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law." Come, Holy Spirit, take your place in our heart. Make your dwelling within us. Let us see a transformation in our life. Empower your people. Grant your gifts to our young people and children. Bring security to the elderly among us. And bring hope to our life. Give us the courage then to be true witnesses for you. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Glory above, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. As we gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display
towards the end of the service. We're going to say farewell to our brothers and sisters who join us on Facebook now. You may stay around to listen to some of the news around St. Andrews. Yeah, that would be great to have you. So that's great. But before that, just to say that this evening, we are bringing to an end, to a conclusion, the Thy Kingdom Come prayer initiative. The wave of prayer that started on Ascension Day this evening at 8 o'clock. So please, on Facebook, on Zoom, we are back on again. So don't forget and join up from 8 o'clock as we celebrate the goodness of God, his power to make us witnesses, and his love to draw many people into his kingdom. So let's receive the blessing of God. The Spirit of truth lead you into all truth, give you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and strengthen you to proclaim the works and word of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, with those whom you love, today and always. Amen.
Spirit, break out, break our walls down. Spirit, break out, heaven come down. Spirit, break out. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down.
sky revival. We want to see.